teams that are very used to doing things out of the clear blue. Here today in San Diego, Utah State picked at the bottom of the Mountain West at 19-2 now. San Diego State and their crazed fans with great artistry in the crowd off that NCAA championship runner-up position last year. Utah State 7-1 in the league. San Diego State off a loss when they're typically very good, now 5-3, but this is the team everybody aims for in this league. Jason Benetti, Casey Jacobson, Allison Williams will join us in a moment. This is going to be like two football helmets running into each other. So physical today.
Yeah, this might be the most physical game in college basketball that you watch today. Utah State comes in here. They have proven they are more than just a feel-good story that they were 2 months ago. They're first place in the Mountain West Conference, but if you want to stay first place, if you want to win this conference, it goes through the San Diego State Aztecs and their man-to-man defense.
It is one of the most efficient defenses in the country, 5 years running, and the guys in the two gold squares are the very physical presences Casey was talking about. The top two scorers and rebounders in this conference, Great Osabor, the transfer from Montana State who came with his coach, and then Jaden Ledee, who was a role player for the tournament team last year and now has really become the centerpiece.
Yeah, Ledee, one of the most improved players, not just in this conference, but in America. Both of these teams are physical and play through their best players. Expect a lot of post touches, and we'll see defensively what kind of double team schemes each one have.
It is not an exaggeration to say this is one of the best home courts in college basketball, and Brian Dutcher has been so good here, but also in the position he's in today after a loss.
Bounce back opportunities. That's where your true team character comes, and this team takes on the personality of their head coach, Brian Dutcher, who's a grinder.
All day we will see Osabor and Ledee touching the ball. They jump center, and with the rhythmic stomping and clapping, San Diego State has it first with a change to their lineup. Darion Trammell into the lineup. That's a miss for Lamont Butler, and it is out of bounds to Utah State for their first touch. This guy, Danny Sprinkle, had no points coming back for Utah State when he showed up here. Some guys transferred out, he brought in a couple guys, and they somehow are 19-2 with nobody back.
He's done one of the best coaching jobs in the country. This Aggie team has gone from a new roster, cool story in non-conference, to where they are right now, and they've earned it. They already have a road win at Boise State, one of the toughest places to play. Can they do it again here?
There is Jay Powell fronting the entry feed. It's off of him. Utah State will keep it. What do they have to do to win in this building, Utah State?
Well, they got to have a great performance from Great Osabor and a fantastic and game-controlling performance from number 10 in Navy, Darius Brown, their stellar point guard.
They doubled Osabor there, forcing a jumper for Isaac Johnson, the Oregon transfer. And we're still scoreless, as we might have expected. This could be a defensive battle today. Ledee crashing into the paint for the opening two.
The biggest difference to me between Great Osabor and Jaden Ledee is Ledee really offensively loves the mid-range. That floater is an example. He's more of a face-up big. And Great Osabor is more of a ball-handling perimeter guy on the perimeter as far as a passer, and excellent in the post.
Here's the freshman, Mason Falslab, out of the state of Utah, and he has the opening two for the Aggies.
Falslev is a driver, and San Diego State defensively knows that. More than 60% of his total shots are at the rim. He doesn't want the perimeter shot.
Well, Danny Sprinkle says it. He says pound the paint. That's what they like to do. That's what they want to do, and they certainly will run as well. Brian Dutcher said these guys run on the road even. That's a really tough entry. Osabor hits the deck and spits it out somehow. It's an open three that goes down for Ian Martinez, the transfer by way of Utah to Maryland, and now here.
And the best three-point shooter for this Aggie team. So San Diego State, they got to beware of Darius Brown II and Ian Martinez. Martinez, last 3 weeks, is playing the best basketball of his career, 19 points per game. Really starting to blossom.
He is top 70 in the country in three-point percentage, 43% for the year for Utah State, and both of these teams have great three-point defenses. Late shot clock, Ledee knocks it down.
Yeah, they're going to the D in that mid post. We haven't even seen him get a deep post touch yet. I think that's where Ladie feels like he has the advantage against Asabor.
Tangled down there now. Asabor battling for position. He did not see the ball, so Brown. And Utah State continuing to fill it up.
Yeah, it's been a joy to watch Darius Brown in the second form. A sixth-year senior has been around the block a few hundred times. And interesting to me, Jason, is Darius Brown is more aggressive on the road.
Oh, boy, the attack for Jay Powell on basically a one-timer from Ladie.
Well, if there's going to be post-double teams, you have to feel that if you're an Aztec. Ball goes to Jaden Ladie. Don't stand and watch. Cut to the rim.
Martinez cutting, didn't get it back. It's on the ground and picked up by Asabor to the rim.
In a game that might come down to one or two possessions, how about those 50-50 balls? Can you get an extra possession, and what can you do with it?
And live ball turnovers as well. Brian Dutcher isolated when we chatted earlier today. That is a big first foul against Isaac Johnson. Darion Trammell created it. Johnson, according to KenPom, more than 7 fouls per 40 minutes. And if he has to come out for any substantial amount of time, that opens the floor down low for Ladie.
No question. This is a Utah State team that isn't very big outside of Asabor. Right? They're not wide. And when you play San Diego State, they will beat you up in general, but especially if you go small. They have the type of athletes and type of scheme that'll make you pay.
Well, when we were talking to Danny Sprinkle earlier, he said, look, you know, this foul trouble could be something. We were chatting with him yesterday about this. You have to keep those big guys on the floor if you can, but fouls have been an issue for both big guys in terms of creating them for their opposition. They both do it very well. It's deflected out and picked back up by Asabor. Brown pull up in transition, and he missed it strong.
Head coach Danny Sprinkle is standing right in front of us at our broadcasting position, and he was really upset that there wasn't an Aggie on the floor for that last loose ball.
Ladie circled back out and tried to fire it for Powell. It's out of bounds off of San Diego State. If you haven't seen these teams play, you've seen a pretty good snapshot so far. Big guys and some running as well.
This could be, when it's all said and done, the game that might decide who wins this conference. Who's going to get on the floor and get those extra points? Right now, Utah State on top.
Fox College Hoops is sponsored by Progressive Insurance. Bundle home and auto and save. Lovely San Diego, California. And we say hello for the first time today to San Diego native daughter, Allison Williams.
Yes, Jason, I am a local here, and locals will tell you that this conference belongs to the Aztecs. Yes, you have the Utah State team, a retooled Utah State team, currently leading the conference. But the Aztecs are the defending champs, a program that has won 16 Mountain West championships. So they will tell you they own this conference. Jane and Ladie, and we want to make it real clear. You want to win this conference, it goes through here. We do what we do, and we make sure everybody knows we run this conference. Lamont Butler said, I feel like we're the top dogs in the Mountain West, and we just have to come out ready to play and remind everyone of that. But guys, I get the sense early, while Utah State is aware, they're not intimidated.
I would agree with that, Casey, wouldn't you?
Absolutely. And I knew coming in, I mentioned it in the open, this is not a fluke that Danny Sprinkle's team is number one in the Mountain West Conference. They showed what they can do by winning at Boise State, a place that not too many people are going to win at. Here we go, on the floor right now.
Just fell. Jay Powell goes down for it. It's on the sideline. He wants a timeout. And I believe we're going to get a whistle against Utah State and Falslev.
Oh, these unforced turnovers are brutal for teams and coaches right there. Just Ian Martinez being hounded. Yeah, I don't like that matchup. That's Lamont Butler, Jason, I believe, is one of the best perimeter defenders that we have in America. I mean, Kevin McCullough Jr. of Kansas, Lamont Butler is right there with him.
Speaking of, Lamont Butler and Micah Parrish off the bench for his first two. Those guards playing together. Parrish came off the bench, the transfer from Oakland. Martinez had it knocked away, got it right back. He wanted the fadeaway one-legger, and he threw it to the corner, somehow got it through, and that goes down for Falslev. And Danny Sprinkle just looked to his bench like, what just happened?
That was a gift that should have been a turnover, and most of the time in Viejas Arena, that thing is going the other way. Credit Utah State sticking with it.
That is the type of possession you just need on the road. Parrish off the curl, sticks a second straight jumper.
Micah Parrish is due for a breakout game for the Aztecs. He's a good scorer, but he hasn't been in double figures in each of his last five games. He's coming off the bench today. A really nice start for him.
He's followed the Allison Williams tour from Michigan originally, now San Diego native. Brown got hit, and he cans the jumper.
And Brian Dutcher over there is claiming that Darius Brown II pushed off with his off arm. We'll take another look here. Watch him use that right arm to push off. And then, look, that was, there's a push up right there with the right arm. I'm fine with letting that go as long as they're going to call it both ways. But here's what I saw. I saw Darion Trammell kind of just breathe a sigh of relief and say, oh, he's not going to do anything. He relaxed and he made it pay.
Who had it worse, Darion Trammell or Brian Russell?
Brian Russell definitely got pushed harder.
Yeah. So Brown knocks down the jumper. He gets himself a four-point play. The guy who came here with Danny Sprinkle from Montana State, along with Osabor, to create a foundational piece for this team. As San Diego State has made four straight buckets.
Aggressive early double team there.
Ladeev, foot on the line, missed it for two. Osabor yanks down the rebound. You have to imagine this pace favors Utah State so far.
It does. They want to get out in transition. You already mentioned how good they are in transition. One of the best teams in America out on the break. 69% Utah State shoots in transition. That three was not great.
It was not. Adugie with the miss. And here is Powell flashing to the foul line. That will be available against Utah State. He bluffed a three. Late shot clock, San Diego State will grind you down. Double from Johnson and a foul against Adugie meeting Powell.
All right, I was looking forward to seeing the coverage defensively on low post touches. And right now, Danny Sprinkle and his team, they're mixing it up. Sometimes it's coming from the strong side. This time it comes from number 20, Isaac Johnson from the weak side. A big-to-big double. And why would you do that, Jason? Big-to-big, if you have your hands up, it makes for a difficult pass. Whereas if you double-team from a guard, it can be easier to see over the top.
The thing is, you probably will see some doubles from guards as well because neither team shoots it great from three, right?
These are two of the weakest three-point shooting teams in the Mountain West Conference.
And two of the best three-point defenses in the country, both top 20 at preventing threes in the nation. Parrish gave it up. Saunders with the miss and a high climb for Brown on the rebound. Utah State out of Logan, Utah. They have not won an NCAA tournament game since 2001, but they have been there a lot. And a big-time block from behind by Bird. Parrish, oh, he got bailed out. He was going to travel. He pinned it to his elbow, and he got fouled instead.
Yeah. You're going to see a lot of pick and roll from Utah State. And watch how Ladee goes back to Osabor, and he says, you know what, if you want to finish at the rim, watch him retreat right there. And just when you think you have a open gap to drive, Bird comes in. He's got those bird-like,
talons.
Yeah, or I was gonna say wingspan.
Oh, okay.
I was thinking.
Well, at the end of the wings are the talons.
Gotcha.
Up top. Another jumper goes down for Parrish. He has an early seven.
Right, he's really struggled with his three-point shot. Talked about him recently, 21% from three in his last six games. You wouldn't know it by watching him right now. He looks ultra confident and locked in.
His name came up quite a bit in terms of three-point shooting in practice yesterday for Utah State. Brown, extra pass, got into the corner, and that went off the window for Martinez. False led to follow, no dice. Attack, missed it, and we have a foul on the push. Looked like Carson Templin for Utah State. And they're going to say he was going back up, so two shots coming.
Shooting there. And watch Micah Parrish wide open. Where's the defensive communication there? Yeah, he's calling long distance on that one. And here he's feeling good, right? So now Parrish has a couple of jumpers go down, and he's going to attack. A very late whistle on that drive.
And I don't know that I'm sold he was going back up. So it's going to be
the wrong guy. There we go. That makes more sense.
Yeah. So they were saying he was going back up, and you saw he was trying to gather. And evidently, Eric Curry, the nearside official, thought had he gathered, he was going to put it back. So they'll give Heidi two free throws, where he's now 3 for 10 on the year.
Yeah, we were both confused on that. But interesting to me is both coaches said, you know what the biggest key to this game is? This game really is going to start when either team shoots the ball. And that battle down low for rebounds are going to be critical. Because, again, neither of these teams really shoot it well from three. They love it inside the paint.
They absolutely do get a big chunk of their points from the foul line. And then Utah State shoots very well from two, but does not prevent twos great. As we get a foul on the floor. And if it's going to be a tight whistle, we will see who's available late in this game. You know what, though? It's not a bad place to spend your weekend, both in terms of basketball and the weather. Viejas Arena is live, and so is the marina. First place, Utah State by two. We go inside the huddle with their coach, Danny Sprinkle.
When we drive, they're coming from behind, okay? You got to know when you're driving that thing, there's guys coming trying to get back to you. Protect the ball. We might even be able to snake it, okay? We're going to start. If we go turn two, we'll go turn two out. Okay? I want Darius to set it and get out. So that way, you're just coming off. Make sure we get a lift.
San Diego State is hard to break down in general. You're not going to have that many avenues to drive, but when you do, you can't think like, ah, I made it. You have to protect the ball, be strong, play off 2 feet. And the other thing he said, that we might have to snake it. What does that mean? In pick and roll situations, the ball handler sometimes, instead of just driving to the basket, you kind of make an S curve into the lane, almost like splitting the double team, and snake it into the lane, which gives you more outlets when you get the ball to the middle.
I have a follow-up on that after this possession as they skip it into the corner. It's a shot fake and a step back, and that won't fall for Martinez. So if you're aware of a back tap, as Trammell pulls the trigger and hits it for three. Getting just his third start of the year, his 40th at San Diego State, the lead for the Aztecs.
If they can get 3-point production from Trammell and Micah Parrish like they've done in this first half, takes so much pressure off of Jaden Ledee to carry this offense. Nice pass.
Hey, nice catch. It's swatted into next Tuesday, blocked away, and they will say it's a goaltend. They're going to take a look at it as Bird ripped it away in the air.
Oh, I don't know there. Bird already, by the way, with a block. Hey, I think that's a play on, partner.
Let's see.
Ooh, man, I think it's right at the top. I think he got there. That would have been his second block.
I agree with you. I don't think that was coming down quite yet. So tough live.
Yeah, very tough. Look at the defense from Darius Brown. Number 10 in Navy was the Big Sky Defensive Player of the Year last year.
Parrish, that one's pancaked by Templin, and they're going to say San Diego State ball late in the shot clock. Danny Sprinkle saying, hey, the clock went off, so that should be a violation. Now Curry is saying there should be one on the shot clock.
Yep, and he might be right. If this ball is blocked directly out of bounds, there would have been a little bit of time. We get another look at that. I think they're going to go to the monitor here, no?
They are. They're coming over here. So Darren White and Eric Curry are coming to the monitor. Watch it again.
So if that ball doesn't hit the end line, though, it's hard to see from that angle as well. If that ball does not hit the end line, that definitely would have been a shot clock violation. But they were adamant that it did.
Got to get a shot up fast here.
Catch and shoot. Lob to the rim.
And it's taken away by Osavor. quickly enough that it leads to a run out for Falslev, who drops it off, and Martinez is fouled. So because Osibor made that catch, it created a fast break opportunity.
Yeah, obviously it backfired. San Diego State offensively didn't have much choice. A lob to the rim is your best option right there, but Jaden Ledee couldn't get any lift. And again, Brian Dutcher, head coach of San Diego State, is well aware if Utah State is allowed to play in transition in the open floor, this is going to come down to the end of the game. They are devastating, the Aggies are, in transition. 69%, that is by far the best field goal percentage on the fast break in the Mountain West.
This is their best scoring offense in Logan, Utah since 1988. Since well before Stu Morrill even arrived there, the legendary coach who is having a ceremony to have the court named after him next week in Logan. Sort of a hush has come over the crowd. The shot making has gone dormant.
I compare it to football. The home crowd, they like to be more quiet so the offense can hear the calls, right? And then on the defense, they're going to make their noise to try and distract their opponent.
The calls from the offense or the analysts?
Both.
Martinez the kick. Falslev knocks down the jumper, and Mason Falslev from local Benson, Utah, has an early eight.
He only attempts two threes a game. That's only his 13th make of the season. When he's open, he's got to take those. That's off his leg.
It is, and it's a good call by the nearby official, Jason Gerritsen.
So much attention will be on the paint, right? So role players and guards like Mason Falslev, Ian Martinez, are going to have opportunities to score. And look at Darius Brown just doing yeoman's work out there, active hands.
He is one of the leaders on this team, and he guns a three. Front iron, and the rebound nearly yanked down by Bird. Taken away by Osibor flashing in.
The second time that great Osibor has been the benefactor of kind of one of those loose balls in the backcourt. Should have been going Aztec's way. A couple of free buckets for the Aggies.
Oh. Brown playing the passing lane there. Beautiful dribbling by Ledee, somehow sneaking that through.
And we concentrate so much on Osibor and Ledee down low. It's actually been their perimeter play, their mid-range game, that has shined.
It is a great point, and it makes them so dangerous in an NCAA tournament setting. There's a hard drive and a foul. Isaac Johnson needed one of those runaway truck ramps they have in the Rocky Mountains. Foul is on Ledee. That's his first.
Runaway truck ramps, that's like when your brakes go out, yeah, and you have no choice but to go off on that ramp and it stops you like that.
That's right. The friction, and they sort of cushion the out of control nature of it.
That's my first hearing that analogy. I'm a big fan.
Thank you. Yeah, your tone suggested that maybe what you're saying about being a big fan wasn't exactly true, but no. I appreciate you playing along.
75% true.
Take it away, San Diego State on the run. Nice touch, and a drive and a foul. Waters to Powell, who got hit. Jay Powell has been everywhere. A couple of junior colleges. He went to Jacksonville State in Alabama briefly. He then played at Campbell University. The Fighting Campbells, maybe best known for the Orioles outfielder Cedric Mullins coming through there. But originally from Omaha, Nebraska. And that free throw is no good for a San Diego State team that's right middle of the road, 73% as a group. Powell is usually very good at the line.
Yeah, Jay Powell already got one of the first possessions of this game. He got a dunk off a double team of Jaden Ledee. And coming in, it was important for him, for Jay Powell, to see a ball go through the basket. Had not scored a basket in the last two games. And only one rebound combined in those last two games. He's got to be more active, and he has been in the first 12 minutes of this one.
They will be more active here, heating up Jackson with Falslev out. Mason Falslev with his second personal foul. He's got two. Adugie has two as well. And a knock away. It is Powell on a run on the poster. This is the type of storm San Diego State can create here. A quick 5 points.
One of the best man-to-man defensive teams you will watch, the Aztecs.
Asabor twirling in the lane to quiet the crowd for a moment.
And to beat this good defensive team, you've got to either get dribble penetration or pass penetration. Pass penetration is much harder to guard as a defensive unit because the ball moves way faster through the air than it does on the ground.
As it did there to Powell, who dumps it down low. Ladie is doubled. It faded back. Johnson went away from him. Powell on the offensive glass. Beautiful handwork to control that ball. And it's an open three. Waters over a late closeout. And Asabor the rebound.
Nice to be able to have your center get the rebound and start a break. You have just three assists a game.
Beautiful knock away by Trammell. Waters keeps control and he's fouled by Martinez. That was a little bit of a stumble into a foul on Martinez.
Well, Jay Powell had not scored a basket in his last two games here in the passing lanes. Already his second dunk of the first half. But Utah State has answered. Great Asabor with the spinning shot. Utah State still ahead. Watch the trick. We're back in San Diego. Utah State is riding their dynamic duo of upperclassmen who played together last year. This is great Asabor. If you haven't seen him play, you're in for a treat today. A big man that can do a little bit of everything. And his running mate is the sixth-year senior, Darius Brown II. This is his first time playing at Viejas Arena. Off to a really nice start, just taking what the defense gives. He's not super fast. He's not super athletic, but he's really skilled. And these guys, what's surprising to me, Jason, they played last year at Montana State, and they go to a better, clearly a better Mountain West Conference than the Big Sky, and their numbers go up. That's incredible.
This very easily could be a five-bid league this year. The Mountain West, Montana State, was a single-bid league. And I love what Danny Sprinkle said about Asabor, who grew up until age 12 in Spain, and then he moved to England. And Asabor has talked about the different styles in Spain, more of a team game, England more of a run-and-gun sort of situation. But Danny said, sometimes you watch him move, and it looks unnatural. And you say, well, how come he did it like that? Or why is he moving like that? And then you watch him put the ball in the basket yet again, and you're like, he can do whatever he wants to do.
He's a playmaking big guy, right? Every coach in America would love to have a playmaking big guy. We've talked a lot about how good these defenses are. This Utah State is the best and most efficient offensive team in the Mountain West, but they do it in their own way. They don't shoot a ton of threes. They're not good at shooting threes. So how could they do that? I don't think it's possible unless you have a big guy that can handle the ball and also be a passer and scorer. And that's what great Asabor is.
If you feel like this has been a long conversation, it's because the officials are looking at that goaltend that people have been asking about on the social media channels. It was, let's see, here's a block there, but there was a shot earlier that ended up counting as a goaltend. So Casey's going to get the conversation. And what I'm hearing is they're going to keep it as a goaltend from earlier. That block that counted for two for Utah State. Casey, what was the explanation?
Not enough to overturn that. So they are going to leave it as what was called, which was a good basket, two-point basket.
So Utah State got 2 points out of that on a ball that was right around. It was Miles Byrd who blocked it away for San Diego State. It was right at the pinnacle, it looked like.
Yep. I mean, I didn't want to tell him that I disagreed. But, you know, again, it's like it's one of those 50-50 ones. And how they call it is usually how, you know, if it's unclear on the replay, they're just going to stay with the call made.
We've had so much action at the rim. There have been a lot of plays that have been at the basket. Here it is again.
Yep. They just said that wasn't clear enough. I understand that part. I do.
And I understand if you're a San Diego State fan, you're like, well, if it wasn't coming down, it was just thinking about coming down, right? Like it was on the way to be coming down, but they will say there's not enough to overturn. And so it's a 2-point game, and we soldier on. Trammell right in Brown's pocket. I mean, right there, stapled to him.
Tramell and Lamont Butler right now who's guarding the ball. You have two of the best defenders. Look at them go. Look at them.
Really working Martinez, who got the kick to the corner. That won't fall for Jackson, who has to play with the two fouls for Falslev. To the wing, hard drive, and a foul as Tramell got himself to the rim for his second trip to the free throw line. Two shots coming. Allison listening in with San Diego State. What do you have?
Yeah, inside the San Diego State huddle, defensively, they're telling their guys that Utah State is not scoring on plays. It's the other stuff that's hurting them. The offensive rebounds they're able to get. They said they'll blow it up, but then they still allow them to score. They still don't get that stop. They need them to play with more energy throughout the entire defensive possession. Make the second play over and over again to win this game.
And I think, Allison, to your point, that happened. You could see the transmission of that message on that last possession.
Yeah, amped up, right? You can feel it if you're here. I don't know if you can tell at home watching this game on TV, but the man-to-man, look, there are a handful of man-to-man defensive teams, Jason, this year in the country that I'm just like overwhelmed by. When they are right and when they are properly motivated, can really tighten the screws. The Houston Cougars top that list to me, but right below them might be the Aztecs year after year, especially on the perimeter. Here's the last thing I'll say. Look at it.
Weird to see how Jackson sped up there. It got tipped into the backcourt by Waters, so he's allowed to go back, but that's exactly what you're saying as it was happening.
Yeah, the one thing they don't have is a rim protector. They had Nathan Mensah for 5 years here protecting the rim. That's not this team.
Brown himself open, and that is just nasty.
You play fantastic defense, and then just a really good, smart, clutch player drills one. You got to tip your cap and just say, hey, we're going to keep playing hard.
And it buys them a little time, Utah State as well, with some foul trouble building. Parrish misses. Powell popped it in the air, and here's Brown, but two fouls on Johnson, Falslev, and Adugie, and that pass was needless. Danny Sprinkle is not happy.
You can't have unforced turnovers on the road. I know Utah State's still winning here, but you can't just throw away the ball. That is not bad defense. Lamont Butler is in front. You make him make this shot off the bounce, step back from about 23 feet. Goodness.
That's just ridiculous.
Yeah, he hit that game that, or he hit a three, Darius Brown the second, against UNLV that gave them a chance to win, and then Osabor finished it at the foul line.
Loads up. He was wide open. Nobody around. His eighth three of the year.
Wow. Jay Powell. Yeah, you can hear the appreciation from this crowd. They haven't seen Jay Powell have an offensive first half ever like this.
Jay Powell has been money so far in the first half. Big game to this point. That's no good. Tipped around. Follow won't go for Adugie, who's playing with two fouls. Brown poking away, and Waters gives it up. It's Butler, and it's a San Diego State lead. And another baseball pass that is just too much. And this is becoming unhinged for the Aggies.
Yeah, just too many unforced errors, looking at passes that aren't there. And when you do that, it gives the home team a chance to really play downhill. And there's that pass that just sailed over the head. Look, Utah State has bigs that love to run rim to rim. But if it's not open, like really like wide open, you can't throw that pass against the San Diego State defense.
Especially when you're playing with two starters in foul trouble and you're kind of losing your grip on the game anyway. That one is well wide. And Utah State will have it. Parrish was hot early with 7 points.
He's going to keep shooting. Micah Parrish has a scorer's mentality. He's now 3 for 7 after coming in making his first two. He might need to pump the brakes just a little bit. That shot was taken with 13 seconds still on the shot clock.
We're watching Allison and what she heard in the huddle happen defensively here. Again, they heat up the ball, and we get a foul against Templin. That's his second personal. He is the fourth Aggie with two fouls.
Foul trouble and turnovers, Jason. A recipe that usually will not work out well on the road in the Mountain West. As Ian Martinez just getting tripped up a little bit. Yeah, I'm not sure where there was a foul. Templin has every right to that basketball.
Yep. Well, that is going to lead to a substitution for Danny Sprinkle that I don't know that he expected to make. Khalifa Sakho, who plays about 9 minutes a game, the junior out of France in his first year at Utah State, is going to have to come in with Johnson and Templin in foul trouble. They are basically dead last in the country in using guys with two fouls.
Yep. They lean heavily on their stars, heavily on their starters. And now, so what do you do if you're Brian Dutcher? How about a heavy dose of Jaden Ladie and test that front line that's small and inexperienced?
He's been around the block 7 years, 53-6 at home in his San Diego State head coaching career. This is really one of the most perilous places to play in the country. And a trap coming on Brown.
Look at Trammell just deny Darius Brown. He's not touching the ball.
Brown the skip. Odugie for Martinez, and he got fouled. Trammell is saying he kicked out his leg. It's the second foul on Trammell. Trammell believes it was the leg kick that drew the foul.
And I believe him. So, yeah, that watch. The right leg. See how he just barely kind of lifted it up.
Trammell's got to be careful. A technical foul would be his third personal foul. So you think that was enough of a move that you wouldn't have blown the whistle there?
I wouldn't have blown the whistle. Look, I played in an era, though. I played in the early 2000s where this wasn't a thing, kicking your leg out to try and draw fouls. We are extra sensitive to that move. We are extra sensitive to protect shooters. Shooters are allowed to jump up and land in the same place without being touched at all. But I do think that Ian Martinez sold that with a little bit higher leg lift than normal. Can't be mad at him, though. You got to do what you got to do to get to the foul line here.
Yeah, you got to try it. Martinez from the free throw line, a big three in a row for Utah State to break a 7-0 run.
All right, 1-3-1 zone for Utah State. I've seen this several times over the last 3 weeks. It has helped them many times in foul trouble or to change the tempo of a game.
They will trap out of it, certainly, at the free throw line. Danny Sprinkle has said, look, that saved us in a couple of spots this year, as you're describing. Ladie is fouled. Danny Sprinkle thought he traveled, and they will litigate that during the break. Tell you what, it is paradise outside, but it is gritty inside. One-point game at the top of the Mountain West. What a ride.
The busiest rhymes ever made by man are going into this mic written by this hand.
Coming up on the Fox College Hoops Halftime Report, Houston and Kansas collide in one of today's three top 10 matchups. Number one, UConn overcomes another injury in a dramatic finish for Memphis in desperate need of a win. Right now, let's send it back to two of my favorites, Jason and Casey. See you at the half, fellas.
Oh, you say that to all the announcers, Mike Hill. Thank you so much. San Diego State.
He really does say it to all, so don't.
I know. I've heard him do it right here on Fox. The Mountain West, we don't say this to all the conferences, right? The Mountain West, at this point, has been the best in the West. First Mountain West team to reach the NCAA title game. Only conference. Every team above 500 in the non-conference. Some huge wins. UNLV beat Creighton, among others. San Diego State at Gonzaga. Six teams with 15-plus wins. The net rankings are littered with these teams. These teams are both the top 25, Utah State and San Diego State. So just eye test-wise, Casey, how good do you feel like this league is that Brian Dutcher says might be the best version in 11 years?
It's fantastic. 2013 was the year that the Mountain West got five teams in the NCAA tournament, a record. I think it'll get at least that many this season. There are only four conferences in the country, Jason, that have four or more teams ranked in the top 35 of the net. The Big 12, okay. The Big 10, yep, predictable. The SEC, we knew that going in. And the fourth is the Mountain West. They did their work early in the non-conference, and they're continuing to do that in the conference season. And let's also throw in, like, the Pac-12 hasn't been as strong.
strong, and they're taking advantage of that.
And Paris takes advantage of the thinness of Utah State in the front court because of foul trouble right there.
Yeah, and he flexes on him too, and great Osabor is down there kind of shrugging his shoulders as well. Osabor does not have any fouls. He needs to be more aggressive and gobble up some of those rebounds.
Sacco with the screen there. He's playing down low with Osabor. They get it to Osabor on a quick spin, trying to get to the rim, and we have a whistle on the rebounding action and a foul on San Diego State.
Yeah, watch Micah Parrish doing work. 6'6", he's only 195 pounds. Far side of the lane, walks all the way around. And there's like a rainbow cut, banana cut. It finds its way in there. And with the right-hand finish, Micah Parrish is a left-handed player.
Looked like there was a ball in the gap, and he was trying to get to third yeah. on a triple, right around second, getting to third.
I think that might have been a planned, you know, schemed-out way. Yeah, a shot goes up, and instead of just bolting right to the rim, you take the long way around.
It was two fouls on Parrish, by the way. Sacco the handoff. Brown hits the jumper, and he has been enormous here in the first half.
And on baseline out-of-bounds plays, they often have Brown take the ball out, and he becomes the most dangerous guy. If they can't get it to great Osabor, he's coming off looking for jump shots.
Waters down the lane. On the turnaround, he missed, and the Osabor rebound.
Jaden Ledee needs to get a few more touches on the block.
Yeah, we haven't seen him touch the ball much recently at all. Adugie out to Martinez, and that was for the lead. He missed it. Ledee with the rebound. It's a good shot.
We spoke to Danny Sprinkle, the head coach for Utah State. He said, today, if we're going to get a win on the road, we need to make 8 or 9 threes. They're going to have their open opportunities. The question is, will they make them? Right now, yes, they are. 5 for 13 from the three, and that's why they're still in this game.
Sacco just picked up the foul. That's his second personal foul. That's the fifth with two fouls. If you saw, Butler kind of hooked that arm around, but it was after the initial contact by Sacco. San Diego State has left some money on the table from the foul line to this point.
And Lamont Butler, I'm not sure what's going on with him, a fantastic player, but just 48% from the foul line this year. He shot 73% last year. And the rest of his shooting numbers, Jason, are fantastic for Lamont Butler. But something on the free throw line has him shook.
San Diego State fans will trade that shot from the baseline for any miss from the foul line forever, I would imagine,
yes.
For Butler. Brown, tough pull-up, legs flailing. He missed it. Osabor.
Oh, he hit it
back. He's hard into a San Diego State player, and they're going to stop play. Butler down on the ground. They stopped play with Butler down. Danny Sprinkle can't believe that they stopped play.
Watch his head just bang right off the court. Actually, I don't even know if it hit.
Okay, that's a really tough situation. The crowd wants a foul against Osabor.
I don't think his head hits the... He gets hit right there. Watch. His head did not hit the floor, yet he grabs the back of his head. Confused there.
Do you think they should have stopped play?
No, but here's the thing. You want to be sensitive to Lamont Butler, who's on the ground with what appears to be a head injury. You want to be sensitive to that. But how often in a game of basketball do they stop at mid-play?
Very rarely, and that's why Danny Sprinkle was very frustrated. Shot clock went off. The ball's down on the ground, and this is going to be San Diego State basketball. This is getting a little hazy.
Hazy?
Yeah, cloudy.
Cloudy.
Foggy.
In San Diego, sometimes they have that June gloom. It takes a while to burn off around here.
Yeah, all 3 days that the weather's not good here. No. I don't want to hear about it.
There's nothing more annoying than somebody from Southern California complaining about weather.
That's right. That's absolutely right. Bird tries to bowl it in for Powell. One-on-one with Osabor. Kind of wedged him in the lane. Pull up Butler. Front iron, rebound Martinez, and that's off at San Diego State and Jay Powell. This is a grinder down
yeah.
low.
Yeah, interesting that Jay Powell gets a touch on the block, yet Jaden Ledee is just working. He's trying to create space. Let's give Sacco some credit there, who's making him work. He's got a big body.
We have a whistle and a timeout. Danny Sprinkle. Five guys with two fouls. Crucial minute and a half here for Utah State. We're back in 30 seconds. You never know in the Big Ten. We saw Penn State win at Indiana earlier. Later on, right here on Fox, Tyson Walker in Michigan State against Maryland and Jameer Young. That's next on Fox and the Fox Sports app, 5:30 Eastern time, before we have Caitlin Clark nightside as well. The Big Ten is just all over the place in terms of who's going to win on a daily basis. Wisconsin just took a header this week as well. The Mountain West, if you haven't seen it, probably a five-bid lead out here. Utah State could be maybe as high as a three seed, depending on where their season ends. Asabor missed it for three. Sacco, an offensive rebound. San Diego State really struggled early against Colorado State last time out, defending the glass. Cut by Adugie, and that falls in for Adugie with two fouls.
That is exactly the type of offense in the half court that Utah State wants to get to. Grant, a great Asabor, creating, playing out of the post. He is a fantastic passer, very unselfish.
Ladie the miss. Another offensive rebound for Powell, who's had a massive first half.
He moved great Asabor out of the way like he was nothing. I called out great. He's very efficient on the offensive end, but he has got to be a better rebounder. Again, he's one of the only guys that does not have foul trouble. He's got four rebounds, does Asabor, so far, but they needed him to have seven or eight.
Brown starts his engine, steps back, and misses front iron. Sacco's got to be careful of a third foul, and we got a timeout for Brian Dutcher with 12.3 in the first half. San Diego State has not lost this year when they've been up at halftime. They're 15-0. But that's the thing about Utah State. You mentioned some of the Houdini, you know, find the key somewhere while you're underwater in a box situations. Utah State is 5-1 when they've trailed in the half this year.
Utah State is one of the best second half teams in America. They're winning the second half by an average of 9.3 points per game. That is second in the country. First, number one in that category is McNeese State. They are not scared at all to be trailing. They just don't want to be trailing by double digits. They've done a decent job. And now, if foul trouble isn't an issue in the second half, it's pretty easy to see how the Aggies can get back in this thing.
They've just got to protect those five guys with two fouls. Okay, San Diego State has five offensive rebounds. How quickly do they want to get this shot up?
Yeah, you want to get a shot up with about 4 seconds to go, so you have a chance for an offensive rebound. So expect them to go. If they're going to go with the ball screen, 8 or 9 seconds, get Lamont Butler working downhill. What's the zone here? 1-3-1 zone.
He's got to go. It's a five already. Into the corner. It's Waters. And he knocks it down. And this place is up for grabs.
The soft spot in a 2-3 zone is in the middle. The soft spot in a 1-3-1 is in the corners. They were not aware of where Reese Waters was. A 43% shooter. You might want to mark him.
Biggest lead of the half for San Diego State is 6. Allison with Danny Sprinkle.
Coach, San Diego State now up 6 at the half. What are the biggest things you want to adjust with your team here?
Yo, I thought we did a decent job handling the pressure at times. I thought their pressure dictated our offense, and we have to be more aggressive, and we got to be able to dictate when we have the ball. We got to be able to get by their guards. But, you know, to be only down 6, that was a bad call on my part to go to the 1-3-1, and, you know, we got to adjust, and now we got to make up for it.
How do you navigate the foul troubles in the second half?
Yeah, it's hard. I mean, we just got to somehow play without fouling. They're aggressive, and I know we're being just as aggressive down there, and we got to continue to, we got to power through some of those layups and draw fouls. I feel like we're kind of bailing them out. We're not going into them, and they're the aggressors right now.
Thanks, Danny.
You bet.
Allison, Danny, thank you very much. That foul trouble will be a key in the second half. 42-36 at halftime from Viejas Arena. Utah State at 7-1 in the Mountain West. San Diego State, the defending champs. We send you to the studio. Mike Hill, Donnie Marshall, LaValle Jordan coming your way.
Yeah. Yeah. It's the return of the rap, that fashion is smashing. It's making hard to adapt to this. The pizzazz and jazz in this.
cash in this massive this blast just to make a capture this. DJs throw on cuts and obey the crowd. Just pump the volume up and play it loud.
Skulls flying everywhere. Game summary sponsored by Progressive. Get slam dunk savings today. Just five turnovers for San Diego State. The five players with two or more fouls. All two fouls for Utah State. Really the important number right now. Jason Benetti, Casey Jacobson, Allison Williams along with you. San Diego State in this building is just a different deal.
Yeah, when I watch them play on the road, they're good. When they play here in San Diego, the Viejas Arena, their defense is great. It's stellar. It's elite. And they kind of strangle, especially in the latter part, last 2 minutes of that first half, Jason. They didn't allow Utah State to breathe. They got out in the open floor. And their offense has been shining. Brian Dutcher's got to be very pleased with that. 50% shooting for the San Diego State Aztecs. But Utah State is still in this thing. They're hanging around, and now foul trouble kind of almost reset a little bit.
Allison, what do you have on a halftime?
Well, I talked to San Diego State assistant coach Chris Acker at the half. He said one key for them in the second half is to be better getting after the loose balls. Offensively, as far as getting Jaden Ledee a little bit more involved, he said we have to do a better job of seeing him when he is open. With the way they're playing him defensively, it's not going to be out of set plays. Our guys have to be better looking for him and finding him in open moments. Defensively, they've been good pressuring the ball. He said now the key in the second half, we have to stay in the gaps and do not let them drive by us.
Thank you, Allison, and that obviously will be more stressed because Mason Falslev is going to play more. They hope he had two fouls, and he only played 9 minutes. Johnson only played 10 minutes the first half. Asabor drops the shoulder and scores.
That's the deepest touch that great Asabor has had all game, and it's not a coincidence that they want to set that zone first possession of the second half. Best thing about Asabor's low post game, Jason, his quick decision making. He doesn't mess around with it.
Double came on Ledee, and now fades back, and he attacks on the second try and scores, and there was no double on the second attempt.
Yeah, he knew it, right? He had a one-on-one opportunity. Is he built or what, man?
Big dude. I'm just like a fire plug, but taller.
He is built like a defensive end. I mean, 6'9". Look at Asabor and Ledee just going at it right now. He's pushing him out of that lane.
Waters starting the second half, misses, and Brown, who had 11 in the first half, rebounds. Ian Martinez has been a big-time creator for this team in their 19-2 start. He does for Falslev, who ducks in hard.
Watching tape on this Utah State team, they are very good passing and extremely good at cutting, and the best player as a cutter is Mason Falslev. He just has that feel. It's almost something that you really can't teach.
He was a great player in high school, not only in basketball, but football as well, winning state titles in both sports. And they really missed him when he went out with massive foul trouble in the first half. And that's a pretty clear reach-in foul on Asabor.
Yeah, the reason why Utah State is number one in field goal percentage is not because they shoot it. It's because they attack the lanes off drives and off cuts and in the post. That is how they generate offense and just make it. They're so hard to guard.
So you're saying that's why they shoot 58% from two?
Yes. That's one of the best in the country. Top five.
That is a massive number as Powell dumps it for Ledee, and he kind of got mangled and no whistle. Brown trailing. Missed it for three. Asabor battling Powell for the rebound. Falslev double clutch. Missed it for three. Into the corner. Asabor hits the deck, and it's off his face.
Jason, when you say double clutch for a three-point shooter, that is never a good thing. That means your shot percentage will go from about 35 to 40% to 10. If you're a catch-and-shoot guy, do not hesitate. Inside-outside basketball, step into that one. It's a battle down here, man.
Why take it? Like, why take the shot if you know that as a shooter?
Well, no, I'm saying he should have taken the first one. He should step right into it.
But that's what they call a sunk cost. In econ class, there's a tie-up that's going to go to San Diego State. Once you've done that, and I know it's moving fast, but if you know that, and I know we can pull tape of you taking a shot after a double clutch.
Never. I just caught it and shot it.
Well, that's actually probably a good point.
You stepped right into that one. I don't ever recall shooting a double clutch or like, oh, I'm going to hesitate, now I'm going to shoot it. Most shooters, honestly, decide when the ball's in the air on its way to them, whether or not they're going to shoot it.
Well, no decision time there. Saunders from the corner.
Yeah, he's a three-point shooting power forward, not a post player. More than half of his shots are from behind the arc.
There's a cut for Folslev, and he misses. Utah State trying to hold on to the thread here. Ladie barreling down the lane, and two free throws coming, and Johnson just picked up his third personal foul.
This is just a mismatch, I feel, for Isaac Johnson here. Look, he can't guard him any which way. That's the right call. He was moving into the shooting shoulder of Jaden Ladie right there. He actually hit him right in the head.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, one-on-one, half court, Isaac Johnson versus Jaden Ladie off the bounce. He's got to have some help there.
It's a tough matchup. We talked about Johnson's foul trouble. Ladie is also top 20 in drawing fouls in the country.
He draws over 7 fouls a game. He attempted, what, like 15 free throws the other night last week?
He's got 160 plus. It was 19 in that game you're talking about. 160 plus for the year. Largest lead for San Diego State, and the crowd follows suit. Martinez off the Osabor screen. Johnson was met at the rim by Ladie. Second chance and a big one right on the welcome mat. Osabor, no, but Johnson is there for two. Utah State right now just won't go away. That's a tough two for Waters. They didn't really need.
Utah State was happy to say, hey, you want to take that one, go right ahead.
Brown knifing through. This is 4-on-4. It's like overtime hockey the other way. Saunders, head forever.
Well, Tulof.
Ooh, it's out of bounds to San Diego State. Folslev couldn't collect it.
So we talked about the hesitation for Folslev, and now Elijah Saunders took way too long. It's wide open, and here's why I mentioned it, Jason. In practice, as a shooter, you don't practice catching the ball and holding it for a full second before shooting. And sometimes when you're so wide open, you think a little too much.
We see on the replay what Folslev was frustrated about. He got hit in the head by Ladie, who knocks down the jumper. 5 already in the second half for Ladie.
He is almost as good in the mid-range as he is in the post. It is a large part of his game.
Oh, one. Osabor stalking Ladie. And that's good. I mean, that was just human on human. Me and you. Let's go.
Human on human as opposed to human against, like, alien? I don't know, man. Guys.
Thank you for the clarification. Oh, D with the answer.
That was a line drive. Shall I say an ugly arc on that shot, but it doesn't matter. These fans here don't care. His 12th three of the year.
False left, got to the rim. From a standstill, by the way.
Be a star in your role. And Mason Folslev is that. He knows exactly what his strengths are and how he plays off of Osabor and Darius Brown.
So his plus minus in the first half was plus 4. He was one of 2 guys with a positive plus minus in the first half, and they missed him when he was on the bench in a big way.
Whoa.
Parrish. He went to his ear afterward, and boy, did he dial it up. False left. Osabor cross lane.
Beautiful pass. False left. Living in the lane right now, and Osabor, he's a right-handed player. Osabor, he actually prefers finishing to his left.
Offensive rebound, Ladie. He wants to go straight back up. Punched by Osabor. Waters slicing in and a soft touch.
Osibor had a chance to grab that with two hands. I'm not sure why he punched it out, but Waters was right there.
The USC transfer Waters, refeed from Brown. He said, you take it, and Trammell just picked up his third personal and finally a break. San Diego State is streaking.
The two leading scorers and rebounders in this fantastic Mountain West Conference are showing up and showing out. Osibor with a jumper, and then Chade Lundy with the three, is 12th of the season. San Diego State strong in the second half.
Utah State, first place in the Mountain West, one of only three teams in the nation to bring back no points from last year. So who would vote them any higher than ninth, right? Well, they're 19-2. They're number one in the Mountain West, 17th overall. And they've been a staple in the NCAA tournament, but the last time they won a tournament game was 2001. It was a 5-12 upset, and that same day, you were playing in this arena.
Oh my goodness, yes we were. We beat UNC Greensboro, and then 2 days later, we barely beat St. Joe's. Jameer Nelson, and yeah,
that was above the rim, Casey there.
Barely, you can't even tell. That's why they had the overhead shot. You can't really tell how high I jumped.
Let's quiz you. Do you remember who had the big game for St. Joe's in the second round of this building?
Of course, you know I know the answer to this. Marvin O'Connor.
How many points did he have?
He scored 38 against me.
Oh, it was against you?
Yeah, it was against me.
I just saw the box score. I saw the 37, and I was like, man, it's a big day.
Come on.
Osibor called for the foul. The entire Utah State bench is livid right now, not because we showed Casey, but because of the foul call.
It's hard enough to win on the road, and these coaches and the assistants, they go through so much to prepare for these games, and they're living and dying on every foul call.
And we are sitting right next to this bench for Utah State, and that was as much of a reaction as we've gotten all game. Lamont Butler. Ladine, 9 in the second half. That's swatted by Johnson. Playing with three fouls, by the way.
A nice move by Lateef. Felt the defense coming and he spun away from it.
Osibor has Saunders, wants to back him in. Help came from Ladee and a foul on the reach in. It's two on Ladee if it's his. It is.
Great Osibor in the low post, prefers the left block, this block that he's on right now. And that looks like a little bit of ball there. Yeah, they're showing the replay here in Viejas, and they're not happy about that one.
The reactions are only going to grow. Oh, Martinez had it blasted out of there. Micah Parrish, yikes.
Oh, Micah Parrish's good start on the offensive end of this game has really propelled him. He's flying around on both ends of the floor. He's super long.
Parrish, who played at Northwood University up in Michigan before coming here, he said they have wolves up there, you know. And that's going to be a whistle and a travel first on Falslev.
You got wolves up there, but they got all kinds of stuff out here in California, like snakes,
coyotes,
fox,
right?
Coyotes, yeah.
You're big into nature, huh? We're learning that today.
No, don't confuse me with Bill Walton. I don't know anything about the lakes, rivers, and streams that surround this wonderful San Diego area.
It's a takeaway by Brown. Trailer Johnson takes it this time. And a big one for Isaac Johnson.
And coming into today's game, Jason, he really struggled with his three-point shot. Just one for his last 11 from deep. And a power forward as one of his biggest weapons. And if Utah State's going to get back into this thing, they got to start hitting some threes. You see it right there, that stat, the second lowest three-point shooting team in the conference.
We'll step aside. That won't go for Parrish, and the rebound for Falslev. There's another back tap coming. Falslev felt it that time. To the theme of nature, Isaac Johnson's nickname is Big Fish.
Oh, okay.
Play, so he knows all the streams and rivers.
Do you know where that nickname came from? Its origins?
I don't. Okay. We'll do some digging.
Maybe he's a flopper? He flops?
I don't think the home team would give you the nickname for that.
Yeah. Fair.
don't know what they did at Stanford. Here's Osibor. Late shot clock, drew front iron, and the rebound for Bird. Miles Bird, that is.
More nature talk.
We take to the air. Pull up jumper, Ladie. And over the top, a rebound wrangled away by Bird to get an open three that won't fall. And the rebound. And a whistle on that rebounding action and a foul. It's on Osibor.
Well, in nature, you got to protect what's yours. Wrestling match going on. That time it's won by Bird, but San Diego State cannot convert. Do not go anywhere. This is going to be a good one.
Do you feel we have enough cowbell here at this point?
Yes, but I'm more interested in the tubas. There's four tubas. I like a strong baseline, Jason. You know that.
Thank you for that. We'll keep showing the percussion. Tonight on Fox, Caitlin Clark rejoins your life once again. 8 Eastern time at Maryland. Tough place to play. Fox Primetime Hoops. And a special treat tonight on TikTok, if you're into that. At CBB on Fox, we'll have Caitlin Cam. Is that self-explanatory enough? It's brought to you by State Farm. You can watch Caitlin Clark all night long.
What if she's in foul trouble and she's sitting on the bench? Do they just have a camera on her on the bench, too?
I have to imagine so.
All right. That sounds riveting.
You think it just goes to color bars? Come on now. Yeah, so this is the most career points in NCAA women's history. She's 103 away from Kelsey Plum. And you figure that's going to fall in 3 or 4 games?
Oh, yeah. Three games, probably. She's in a Kelsey sandwich right now, just past Kelsey Mitchell.
Jeez.
And trying to go. Kelsey Plum, I watched her play a lot at Washington. Left-hander, who's now with the WNBA, I think the Las Vegas Aces.
Certainly a great team out there in the WNBA as Osibor gets the steal. Utah State is hanging around enough. Johnson with 3 fouls. Working on the shorter Parrish. It's a hard cut. It's Martinez who had a 3-point play right there on the horizon. Allison Williams.
Guys, Danny Sprinkle telling his guys during the timeout they have to continue to be aggressive offensively. He wants them to work cutting, getting to the rim, playing through contact. On the rebounding side, we knew this was a huge concern. He said, how would we match up with them physically rebounding? It's like, guys, you're batting the ball around. You need to go up strong with 2 hands and bring it down. He said, we have to divide this last 11 minutes into 3 4-minute chunks. Win this 4, then we'll worry about the next 4. We get it to 5 minutes, it's a close game. The pressure will all be on them.
Allison, thank you. They're up 1 point here on the Martinez free throw. But it's exactly what you said on the Osibor rebound try, right? That obviously was on Danny Sprinkle's radar when he punched it out.
Yeah, no question about it. You've got to remember that you're playing not against an average physical team. You're playing against probably the most physical team in the Mountain West. So great Osibor. You got to go with 2 hands every time, not just sometimes.
Shot clock down to 7. Post touch for the first time. It's Ladie. Johnson reaching at him. Ladie keeps the dribble down at his ankles. He didn't get that off. Shot clock violation. Utah State providing the defense.
Way too slow just even getting into that. And if you're going to feed the post to Ladie with Jay Powell, you got to cut him out early because the double team is coming right off of him.
Yeah, it said it was all Ladie with like 7 as Brown hooks it to Martinez. Adouje driving. He scores it, but they'll wave it off. It's an offensive foul, and it's his 3rd.
Tough shot by Adouje. Watch him try to side jump. Go to, not a side step, but a side jump right there. Slides to it. I think that should have been a block. There was a little bit of slide. Watch Bird just at the very end leans into that. He's still moving. That's got to be a block there. It's a tough call. They're always tough, but that should have been a block.
And reminder, you can move a little bit if you're in legal guarding position, but if he wasn't in position as the secondary defender before making that move and it created the contact, then it should be a block.
Yep. Before the plant leg, right? Before you explode up for that, and he certainly was still moving then.
Tremel probing, whips it into the corner, and it goes down for Powell.
So often
when you watch college basketball, the home team, they'll have a surprise role player perform. The crowd, Jay Powell gets the surprise start in this game. He has not missed a shot, 5 for 5 from the field.
Kind of like Marvin O'Connor having a big game with Peter Nelson in the backcourt as well. Here's Adouzé, turnaround, didn't have it, and the rebound for Heidi. The freshman yanks it down. Sorry about that side swipe. You're going to be okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. Marvin O'Connor deserves a lot of credit for lighting me up and my team. But we won the game. We moved on.
You won. And yep. We move on as well. Yeah. At some point. Kamel for Powell. He thought about another one. Now he drives instead. Lost the ball. And Adouzé had to step out of the Denver boot back there. Brown had it blocked away by Parrish. And it went off Powell. It was on the end line.
How active has Micah Parrish been on defense? This is the best I've seen him defend at the rim, at the guard position. Watch him hang and block it. Darius Brown's drive, really impressive there. Darius Brown, he's really good at creating contact and getting to the foul line, too.
Ooh, what? That's a close play for Powell on the end line there. Johnson tees it up. Miss it for three. Rebound again for Heidi, the freshman out of the state of Washington.
Well, no Jaden Ledee on the interior. So this is basically almost like a five-out set for the Aztecs. The lane is open.
How do they attack it? Parrish behind the screen from Powell. Driving on Adouzé. Tough shot. Wild shot. Weak side rebound for Heidi. And he gets fouled.
And I don't want to make excuses for San Diego State, but it's pretty clear when Jaden Ledee is not in the game, their offense lacks a little bit of structure. This became a one-on-one play. Good for Heidi to get his hand on the ball and get an extra possession for him. But it's just, it's so clear that this is an inside-outside offense, and right now they almost like don't know what to do.
Yeah, and while Ledee's on the bench, Osibor is on the bench as well. For Utah State, as Heidi is 0 for 3 from the line in the game tonight. There's his first make.
It's an interesting point you bring up with Osibor also being on the bench. I don't know if that's purposeful from these head coaches. Like, hey, one guy's getting a rest, might as well rest my guy as well. Or the other side of the coin is one guy could be out there terrorizing the defense.
Yeah, that's the question. Yeah. If you're looking for plus minus, where you can gain on the margins, Danny Sprinkle does have Osibor with 3 fouls.
Yeah, Jaden Ledee against Isaac Johnson. It's been a mismatch anytime he's had that opportunity.
Heidi picks up Johnson here, and he floats it over Bird.
I was talking about the mismatch that Ledee had against Johnson. Well, he's like, hey, Ledee's not out here. I have a mismatch, a height mismatch skill-wise. That was a beautiful spin move on the block from Johnson. And here comes great Osibor to check in on our next dead ball.
Eight minutes to go. The reach for Powell. Could have been a double dribble there. It was not. Here is Bird with 5. To go, slamming on the brakes, front iron, rebound for Brown. Utah State down 9. Brown with goal eyes, had it blocked by Powell. Folslev, tough pass. Templin going up, and a whistle there as Carson Templin, the freshman from Texas, will go to the free throw line for just the 10th time all year.
Jay Powell, flawless on the offensive end when he's had an open look, 5 for 5, including 2 triples. But Jaden Ledee needs to get back in this game to help them out on the offensive end. Defense is always stout for the Aztecs.
San Diego State, if you didn't watch the NCAA tournament last year, made quite the run. They came out of the pod beating Charleston and then Furman, which had its first NCAA tournament win ever. Into the Sweet 16, Nate Oates in Alabama got defended in terms of lockdown work. Then San Diego State, that close win against Creighton in the semis. Lamont Butler, the huge shot. And then the first team ever from the Mountain West to go to the NCAA title game. They end up losing to UConn, but that defense was just ridiculous last year.
It was awesome, and they have a championship pedigree and mindset. Look, they're used to having slow starts. Three of the last four years, they have had three losses early on, the first month or so of the Mountain West, but they always seem to figure it out. And it's been a different group of guys, different stars. Sometimes it's Matt Bradley this year, Lamont Butler and Jaden Ledee. Brian Dutcher and his staff, give them some credit. Regular season championships, Jason, are a marathon. They're not a sprint. And this team seems to always learn and grow from their setbacks.
Well, and some would say it is the best way to measure a program. Obviously, you want the tournament success. They've had both.
Yeah. And going back to that Final Four run, it meant a lot to this program, but also to the Mountain West, which is celebrating its 25th year. It started in 1999. But, Jason, before last year, no Mountain West team had ever advanced past the Sweet 16.
Yeah.
And in fact, and they had a little losing streak as a conference going into last year. They were 0-7 in their previous seven opportunities as a conference in the first round. They were developing a national reputation as good, but they can't perform on the biggest stage. So for San Diego State to break through and kind of break down that barrier, it helps everyone.
And you figure, as this 1-1 front end is down for Butler, you figure that it's going to help this team going into the NCAA tournament, but it will also help the competition in this league, say New Mexico, say Boise State, Colorado State, some of the other teams that look like tournament teams this year, to go through a better league.
Good question. And right now, you could, like, Utah State has the best record, and Nevada is a tough win. Boise State is a tough win anytime you play them. Those teams are definitely New Mexico. You haven't mentioned New Mexico. Well, Richard Pitino has been building there for his 3 years in Albuquerque.
That's one of the two losses for Utah State at the Pit this year. They also lost to Bradley in overtime in the non-conference. Osabor flashing in, and that is a goaltend off the window. Ledee went up, and it's back to a seven-point game. It's been 10-plus minutes. The game's been in the 7-11 range.
Yep, just kind of hanging around. Utah State not allowing the Aztecs to really pull away. The next step is to close that gap, get on a run, get out in transition. But that half-court set was a late cross screen for Osabor that was not communicated. Uncharacteristic mistake by the Aztecs.
Ledee flashed on the screen. It's batted in the air by Brown. It came back down low. Templin redirected it out of bounds. And San Diego State will have it with seven to shoot.
It's hard to be an official in this game. Guys are driving, and they are diving into the chest. There is contact on every single play at the rim, and the referees have to determine whether or not the defense has legal guarding position. And so far, I think they've done a pretty good job.
Utah State fans will say the free throw discrepancy of 12 is a big one. Templin just got lost down there. Saunders snuck in.
Yeah, the free throw discrepancy isn't quite as big as the Purdue-Northwestern game the other night. 46 free throws for Purdue, 8 for Northwestern in an overtime loss for Northwestern.
Yeah, Chris Collins saw 44 minutes and 59 seconds of that game at Mackey Arena. Brown for three. Missed it too strong. Rebound Saunders out of bounds off of Utah State.
Well, we still have over 6 minutes to go, but you could see the collective, like the Utah State assistant coaching staff, as that ball was shot by Darius Brown, they were like, we need it, we need it. Yeah, right? So if that goes in, you have a new life as a team.
And that's what San Diego State does to you, right? They just constrict the possessions sometimes and make you feel like 9 is 15.
Ledee was wide open there down low.
Saunders for three. Timeout, Utah State. He didn't start, but he's made a couple of daggers.
Got two threes off the bench for Elijah Saunders. And now that Jaden Ledee is creating that gravity in the lane, these are much more open opportunities for San Diego State, who is trying to pull away.
San Diego State by 12. Jaden Ledee affecting this game in so many ways, Casey.
Yeah, as the Aztecs love to run pick and roll with Jaden Ledee. Watch great Osabor, who is in the help side position. As this ball
is reversed. Great Osabor is anticipating a double team. He is locked in on the ball and looking at Jaden Ledee. He has completely lost sight of who he is guarding, which is a three-point shooting power forward. That is an example of what I'm talking about when I say the word gravity. Superstar players, especially bigs, create gravity. The defense sucks towards them, and then perimeter players are more open because of it.
It's a great point, a great catch by you, and then you see what San Diego State has done. That gravity creates open looks. They generally have not made them very much this year, and they're doing it against the fourth best three-point defense in the country this afternoon.
Yeah, take a look at those bench points. The guys who are coming off the bench have been confident, ready to take those shots.
Off the leg of Martinez, picked up by Saunders. And those bench points in part with Brian Dutcher's choice to change his lineup. Powell and Trammell into the lineup today.
Yeah, Micah Parrish, one of their top scorers. The guy that averaged double figures coming off the bench and was awesome and aggressive from the jump.
Out of bounds off of San Diego State. Ledee thought he got tripped.
Watch here. Does he stick his leg out? No. Just kind of lost his footing there. It's a good no call. Yeah, I watch these teams on tape a lot, Jason, and then you see him in person. Great Osabor is massive. His lower body is just, golly, how do you get low and move him off his spot?
Well, he is in volume great, certainly. He's been an outstanding player as well as Brown got hit.
Darius Brown II, he's going to have his chance to go to the foul line here, but he has not had an efficient shooting day, just 4 of 14.
No, he's been quiet in the second half as well. You're talking about Osabor. The name great certainly stands out as it jumps off the page, right? Allison Williams asked the question.
Yeah,
how did he get his name?
Well, I had to find out, right? And I love this story. As a mom, I certainly appreciate it. When his mother was pregnant with him, his mom, Mabel, she said, this is the greatest gift from God. And so she thought, I'm going to name him. And that's how he got the name.
That's beautiful. Thank you, Allison.
I love that. It also puts pressure on your son to be a monster in any sport that he plays, right? And he's responded to that. There's some pressure.
I love Allison's like, what a sweet thing. And competitive Casey says, well, look at all the pressure.
Hey, it drove him. It motivated him. That's
nice. Way to go full circle with that.
Maybe if my name was awesome, I would have played longer in the NBA.
Trammell for two. It's a 12-point game for San Diego State again. Awesome Jacobson.
It rolls right off the tongue.
It does. You missed out naming your kids. Here's Osabor. Johnson in the corner. Didn't have it. Rebound for Ledee.
Yeah, those are the ones that got to go down, right? You're going to sag into the lap of Great and make his space. You're going to shrink his space. Those have to go down. If not, cut and try and get layups instead of threes.
Sap the clock here. This is slow offense anyway. Trammell missed it. Martinez the closeout, and nobody rebounded the ball except for Butler.
Both Brown and Falslev just started to walk underneath the basket. This has to be a must-stop defensive possession for the Aggies here.
Butler the drive down the lane for two. He has been so clutch for this team for years now.
It's only his second basket of the game. Man, a huge screen there from Musselman.
Martinez rimmed it out, and Utah State is losing the thread here.
Yeah, pull this out right here, Trammell, and continue to milk the clock. Lamont Butler averaging 9.5 points a game. That is a career high, but he's been way better in Mountain West play. He's got the ball right now. 12 points per game in conference.
Slev running the floor and a timeout coming for Danny Sprinkle in his first year at Utah State. It's a 12-point game. We'll step aside. It's going to take a miracle, but you know what? We saw it with Wyoming and Colorado State. 11 points very quickly went away a couple of days ago. So 12 with 2:46 in the Mountain West. I don't know. You never know. Call somebody.
Spartans leading scorer Tyson Walker, about 19 a game, leading the way for Michigan State, set for Big Ten action against Maryland. Both teams identical 13-8 records, 5-5 in the conference. We'll bring it to you next on Fox. Jason and Casey.
We apologize in advance if Kevin Kugler, Robbie Hummel, and Bo Garrett's Emmy Award-winning Open gets joined in progress because of our game. 74-62 and a lot of threes for San Diego State.
Yeah, their season high is only is 10, and they have 9 so far in a game that almost feels like a must-win. If San Diego State wants to win this conference, they have to win this game against the Aggies. And they made 9 by 6 different guys. That's probably the most exciting part if you're watching the San Diego State Aztec team and you're hoping they continue to grow and get better. We've seen Jay Powell come in, step in and hit a couple. Elijah Saunders. And you take a look at the three-point shooting today. Yeah, a couple of guys that you would not expect. And even Jaden Ledee had a line drive three that somehow found the bottom of the net.
Yeah, Powell only has 9 for the season. 2 of those today. Jay Powell at back end got mauled. That wasn't exactly a friendly challenge of Powell from Asabor.
Yeah, maul was probably the correct adjective there. Brian Dutcher wanted a flagrant foul for this. I certainly didn't see that. There's nothing wrong with a hard foul as long as you're going for the ball.
Fourth one on Asabor, though. He is the first Utah State player. And Jay Powell, who had 2 points in his last 2 games combined.
And they were both free throws, by the way. He had not made a field goal in his last 2 games.
He was a great defensive player when he was at Campbell. He was top 3 in the Big South Conference in blocks, but the offensive explosion is kind of out of nowhere. But you said it earlier, if you're going to win games like this, like, role players are going to have to show up.
Yeah, and it usually happens at home. You cannot expect to go on the road and have Jay Powell go 5-5, right? You expect that Jaden Ledee is going to show up, Lamont Butler on the road, those are guys going to show up. But at home, with the crowd behind you, is often when you find a role player who feels more comfortable and they make an impact.
This is the rare day, Casey, as well, where Utah State has shot under 50% from 2. And we just saw it there, a ball that danced on the rim but wouldn't fall. And that's been the story in the second half. Powell, a hard cut and a whistle as he goes up. That was a sturdy dive by Jay Powell.
And again, playing off Jaden Ledee, is going to draw 2 guys, cut to the rim, and then there's, it's a good foul by Foslev, but everybody was just watching. All the Aggies defensively just flat-footed and watching. You still have to be on a string, meaning if you move, I have to move with you.
You know what, who would love that connectivity for San Diego State is the late, great, all-time assist leader for this program, Tony Gwynn.
One of the best athletes that our country has produced. 2 sports star like Charlie Ward.
Got drafted by both the San Diego Clippers and the Padres when he came out of San Diego State, eventually coaching the baseball program at Steven Strasburg here. The San Diego State by 15. Martinez. Away from behind again. They collapsed on him, and San Diego State's going to slow it down.
Had it knocked away by the smallest player on the floor, Terrion Tremell.
He's been really active today in the starting lineup for just the 3rd time this year, the 40th time in his San Diego State career, and they're feeling it at Viejas Arena. This is just about on ice. Tremell, wild shot, pawed at by Ledee. And here comes Martinez for Foslev, and an easy 2 there. Take their time getting this in. No reason not to with the clock moving. Over a minute to go and a foul against Foslev, and that's going to be 5 on him.
Darion Tremell's journey has been really fun for me to watch. Jason, I remember him when he started at Seattle U. He was one of the better scorers as a freshman in the country. Averaged over 20 points per game as a freshman at Seattle U, and kind of had the reins of that offense, got to do whatever he wants. So he plays there for 2 years, and he comes to San Diego State, and you're thinking, okay, they need his scoring, but you can't get on the floor for Brian Dutcher unless you are a bulldog defensive player. So he had to prove to everybody that he can not only score but defend at this level. He took fewer shots. He accepted his role. This year he's coming off the bench despite the fact that he was awesome in their Final Four run. And I love watching guys who kind of put their ego to the side and they continue to get better at some of the weak parts that they first had when they started college hoops.
He especially personifies the, you never know when your chance is going to come, right? He ends up at the free throw line against Creighton late in that game in the Elite Eight. Who cares if you're coming off the bench? You're given those shots, you got to make them in order to get to the title game. And there's Asabor for two and a foul. Lead is 13. You know, all of those like basketball sort of axioms sound true until they happen. And you're like, well, yeah, you can say that, but what if you don't get the opportunity? Then you have it, and you can't get the work that you did or didn't do back.
Can't get it back. That's a really good point, right? What's the saying? Success is where preparation meets opportunity.
Yeah.
And you're right. This whole, and we're talking about Darion Trumell and those two free throws that he had against Creighton that propelled them to the Final Four. But you can say that it's a microcosm for this entire San Diego State program that had been knocking and knocking on the door for a long time to break through as a national power. And they finally had the bracket open up for them last year, and they were ready for it.
And they beat a one seed while they were at it, right? Alabama in the round of 16. They're up 12 here. This is certainly a tournament team right now. Utah State is as well, as Trumell just heaves it up for two more, and that's the way it's gone at Viejas today. Jackson, no. San Diego State, the rebound for Pal. And the Aztecs, once again, after a loss, are virtually unbeatable. They were today. 81-67 off a season high from Jay Powell. San Diego State by 14 again here at home.
They continue to be undefeated here. I don't know of any Mountain West teams as good as this conference is that is going to come in and beat these Aztecs. So the challenge for Brian Dutcher's squad is, can they bottle up that same urgency that you saw today for 40 minutes and bring it with them on the road? Both of these teams in the next 2 to 3 weeks are in the season-defining stretches of their season. We'll see how it all plays out. I can't wait to watch it.
It's been a great league. Tough schedules for both coming up. 81-67. Utah State now 1-10 in this building. So that'll do it from San Diego for our entire crew. Eric Billingmeyer, Mitch Riggin. For Allison Williams, Casey Jacobson, I'm Jason Benetti. We go to the studio after a break. Michigan State, Maryland on the other side. San Diego State, a big win.